There's only one Doctor, but there's an entire Doctor Who team. From writers to directors, set builders to costume designers, every word on every page and every shot in every scene is planned meticulously from start to finish.
Doors whoosh open sudden.
The girl in the fireplace is no different, with countless meetings and discussions being held before anyone steps foot on set. You've all seen how episode 4 ends, but where did it all begin?
So we've got a starscape, and then we've got Versailles, which we briefly touched on earlier on, that we'd look into the possibility of actually going to Versailles.
My favourite part of the script-to-screen journey, I mean, there are lots of bits, actually, but my favourite part is when you get that first script and it's good.
It's like getting the latest instalment of this adventure that's kind of a big part of my life, so it's really exciting getting it and kind of flicking through the pages as quick as I can.
Your second read is, of course, always about, oh, God, how do we achieve this? And you start to break it down. And that's exciting because it's the job. And that's when you get to really admire the crew and their expertise and how they come together to make something possible.
When you see a fireplace on this spaceship, you have to think this isn't just some novel feature. This isn't like, ooh, original feature is very nice. It is not meant to be there.
The tone meeting has become, how are we going to make this episode? Meeting, really.
That's the only time everybody sits around the table at the same time, every stage in the development of the episode, and talk about what we're all trying to do.
It's just to get everyone singing from the same song sheet, really, and then that's how we... I think it works, those tone meetings, because that's how we get such a coordinated end result.
Hello, you like that?
Thank you.
But before filming begins, the team hold a read-through to make sure everything goes according to plan.
The read-through for me is terrifying because it's the moment where you get a sense of what is really coming, and you know in that moment, largely, if something is going to work or not.
Everyone.
You just feel the pressure to kind of nail it there and then. Of course that pressure doesn't exist because ultimately all that matters is what is finally in the can, but because it's the first time you're all kind of doing it together in a room, you want to kind of get it right, you want to impress everyone, you want everyone to like you.
Doctor Who? It's more than just a secret, isn't it?
For me, it's always terrifying because it's the first time you've ever read in front of anyone, and also because I didn't audition for this job, I was offered it straight out, and I suddenly thought, God, what if I turn up to the read-through and read it and think, actually, she's...
What did you see?
That there comes a time, Time Lord,
when every lonely little boy must learn how to dance.
For us, it's the final dotting the I's and crossing of the T's. That's where you do final rewrites. Often you can come out and read through, change lines or realise you haven't said something or have a word with the director about the emphasis of a certain scene. It's your final chance before it's all put through in the edit just to make sure everything's working.
OK, so episode 4, scene 1, exterior Versailles night, a perfect, dazzling starscape, pan down to an extraordinary, magnificent palace, and then a scream and more screaming.
We are under attack! They are creatures. I don't even think they're human. We can't stop them.
The moment that a scene that I've read on the page suddenly comes to life and moves me emotionally. When actors breathe life into words in that way, that's really exciting.
Listen to me. There is a man coming to Versailles. He has watched over me my whole life and he will not desert me tonight.
The first pages were quite straightforward. It was classic attack, okay, set in the 18th century, but you've got monsters running down a corridor chasing people.
Doctor! Doctor!
I turned to page 2, which was immediately after titles, and we had gone from Versailles 18th century to a 51st century spaceship.
It's a spaceship! Brilliant, I got a spaceship on my first go!
At that point, I thought, OK, it's not going to be straightforward in the way I thought.
We will build
the corridors of Versailles alongside the corridors of the spaceship, so we get the interaction between the two of them.
And the link between the two worlds is an 18th century fireplace brought to life with some 21st century mechanics.
The main thing we were trying to do with these two sets is obviously make them as contrasting as possible. Obviously, the spaceship is a utility ship. It's very run down, it's very dirty, there's lots of cables, and it's basically been plundered by the droids. And that's set against the plushness of Versailles and the clean lines of Versailles and the colours.
Devin, we found it right on
my favourite visual moment in The Girl in the Fireplace is when Renette dashes from a corridor in Versailles in one shot straight onto the corridor in the spaceship, because it looks magical and impossible. Now, it's not, of course. There's two sets next to each other and she walks through a door, but it seems so extraordinary. When she stands there wearing her beautiful period costume on a set from Alien, it's arresting.
It's at that point, I think, when she realises that she's never going to be with him, that it is a fantasy because his world is so alien to her.
You okay?
No. I'm very afraid.
It strikes me that one of the things you're trying to do all the time in popular television is give reasons for people not to turn off. Right, you imagine the audience sitting down and thinking, oh, I'll watch 2 minutes and I'll go. And you think, well, if I can just keep eking out the reason to keep watching, I'll maybe get them 45 minutes through the show. So you're playing that game. So at that moment in the show, when we think we've got the hang of what's going on, it's starting to become a bit clearer. He walks in and he's face to face with the horse.
The doctor on horseback bursting through a mirror into a ballroom.
You said it was easy, Dave.
This is the kind of climactic scenes in episode 4 where I come through a mirror on a horse, as you do, trot around a bit and save the day again. You know. So that's what we're doing today. It's all fairly extraordinary because it's such a big deal with all this extra crowd and the mirror breaking. Of course, the horse isn't actually here, because the horse isn't allowed in this hall. So the horse has to be on a different day, and it's all one of those, everything has to be put together piece by piece.
It was terribly complicated because we had to shoot elements at Ragley Hall itself with extras reacting to the doctor and the horse.
And crash!
We had to do a separate shoot of the mirror exploding with blue glass. And then we had to shoot on a third day with David and a horse and a stuntman in a paddock that we had to deck out completely in green and turn into a green screen studio. As you can probably imagine, that was terrifically expensive. All of that said, I do think you're not going to see a horse jump through a mirror into a period ballroom every Saturday night.
This morning, now we're filming absolutely crucial stuff, dangerous and incendiary stuff, because we're filming the snog between the Doctor and Madame de Pompadour.
My initial reaction when I read the script was, oh my God, I can't believe I get to kiss Doctor Who.
This is a woman who's a match for him. She's so ridiculously well-educated, ridiculously civilised. So this, you know, if the doctor was going to settle down, it would be a girl like this.
First time ever I saw
your face.
Who is she?
Jean-Antoinette Poisson, one of the most accomplished women who ever lived.
I thought the sun rose in your eyes.
You're right.
And the moon and the stars. Weather gives you gay.
So here you are. My lonely angel. Stuck on the slow path for me.
Yeah, the slow path. Here's to the slow path.
She is the one person who actually knows what it feels like to be the Doctor.
Such a lonely little boy. Lonely then and lonelier now. How can you bear it?
How did you do that?
She's been inside his head. She's seen his past. And she knows how he feels.
Wish me luck.
No.
They have this kind of extraordinary relationship, and yet it's all over before it can begin, which is the Doctor's eternal dilemma, an eternal tragedy.
Enchanted by Madame de Pompadour, and he goes through very, very human emotions of love and loss. And I think it's very intimate, and I think it's good to see the Doctor suffer in that way occasionally. A gust of wind and noise, and the Doctor looks to see the fireplace with the fire going out. The Doctor's face solemn, and he turns towards the TARDIS as the TARDIS noise as it dematerialises. And we're left with the smiling face of Renette. A portrait of her stands just behind where the TARDIS landed.
My favourite part, script to screen journey, is the end.
We're panning across the exterior of the ship and as all its lights go slowly out, and we're left with the name of the ship, SS Madame de Pompadour.
That's why you did it. That's why you went through all those months of writing, all those rewrites, all those meetings, all those design meetings, all that filming, is to get it finished. And I love that. I absolutely love it.